Start bringing your Easter candy in. We've got 2,500 eggs to fill. Woo-hoo! So if you would help us out, and I know you will because you do every year, our community Easter egg hunt is Saturday, April 16th, and we want to have a great time and make a good impact on our community. And to go along with Easter, be sure you grab one of these out there on the table if you haven't already, and grab one you can put on your refrigerator, share it with a friend. This talks about our Easter Sunday service that we're having here on Easter Sunday, 10 o'clock. Let's see, ladies event. They had a ladies event yesterday, and it went very, very well. And they're already planning their next event. They're having a high tea. I don't know what that means. You'll have to ask Teresa or Elizabeth or Vicki about that. That's going to be April 19th, so you need to talk to one of those three. April 9th. Yeah, I said 19th, didn't I? April 9th. So you want to talk to one of them about that and reserve your spot for that. When you came in, I hope that you all got one of your message notes. If you did not get one, you can raise your hand up and we'll get one to you. Everybody got one? Anybody need one? I got one right here. Need one in the back there? Okay. My wife will get you one, Chris. Out front, there's a box that says, a food box that says it's for, I think, food for Cub Scouts. So we've got a Cub Scout amongst us. Y'all know Alex, right? He is wanting to earn a badge for Cub Scouts. And so if we can help him earn a badge. Do you want to do that, church? So you can bring in some canned goods and stuff. We'll put it in that box. It goes through the food pantry over at the Wesleyan Church. And then he will get a badge out of that. How's that sound? Sound pretty good? Does that sound good, Alex?
Oh, yeah.
He's pretty excited about that back here. So that's what that is for out there. Don't forget, next Sunday, we're having our potluck out here, pitch in right after service, and it's going to be Mexican-themed. So I love Mexican food. I hope you do, too. And we're going to have all kinds of stuff out there. There's a sign-up board. If you're like, well, I don't really care for Mexican, that's okay. You can bring something that you do like, and you can join us as well. But you'll see a sign-up board out there at the Family Center. You'll see that. You can look at that on your way out. Offering box is in the back, as always. Thank you guys so much for your continued giving and your support to the local church. We appreciate it very much. Last announcement, I'm calling all spiritual warriors to do some heavy lifting. If you are a spiritual warrior, you're going to do some heavy lifting. One of the hardest things that we do is prayer. Amen? If you are available, we're having prayer service here Wednesday, 7 o'clock. And we pray over, we have a list of people, we pray over a list of things that this church is doing to impact the community. And we just give that hour to God. You can come and you can pray as long as you want, and then you can leave. But we just come and we want to do the heavy lifting of the church. So if you're a spiritual warrior and you're up to some heavy lifting, join us Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Sound good?
Amen.
Amen. Are y'all ready to do some more singing? Yes. But not necessarily, because this is just, we're doing a 3-minute devotional and then we go right into prayer time. So, but for those who can't come, we do have those lists available that has names of people on them. Once again, you've been prayed for this week, not only by me, but also people of the church. So we do have those lists available. If you can't come, let me know. And I got listed in two lists, one of people's names and one of different things that the church is doing that we want prayer for in my office. So do not leave today without hitting me up for those. Sound good?
May I say something?
Yes.
You know, when you have this list of people to pray for, there are people in this world that no one ever lifts their name in prayer.
That's right.
And I think that's the worst thing that can happen to anyone. Mm-hmm.
If you're here today, I guarantee you someone in your life has prayed for you.
Yeah.
And has been influential in your relationship with Jesus. And like I said, you've been prayed for by people of the church. But yes, absolutely. So if you didn't want one of those lists, hit me up before you leave today. Are you ready to do some more singing? All right, if you're able to, let's stand, have a word of prayer, and we'll get into some more singing. Father God, we thank you so much for all that you've done for us, Lord. We think of everything that you've done and how you have stood in our place. God, we thank you for your presence being here. We're asking that we would be able to worship you the way you deserve to be worshipped today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Surrender all I am is yours. Yeah. be still and know you are God.
Forsaken, and I'm accepted. Pastor?
Yes.
So, I want to, you know, my
Yes.
That's awesome. But everybody knows we moved.
Mm-hmm.
And we made a big change in our life. Big change. I went from knowing how much I was going to make a week to not knowing. And it was scary.
Mm-hmm.
But God's love, it's amazing.
Yeah.
We have not had to worry. We have not had to miss out on our kids or grandkids. They come and spend the night. That's my what if story.
Good.
So, just loving Him and praising Him.
Mm-hmm.
That's what if.
What if you do something in your life totally new? What if you did something brand new? You feel like maybe God wants you to do. What would happen if you did that? Today we're going to ask the question, what if I take control of my thoughts? What would happen if I take control of my thoughts? Is anybody here, you don't have to raise your hand, but I think at some point in time, in all of our lives, we've all struggled with what we think about. Can you give me an amen at least on that one?
Amen.
We've all been there, haven't we? So first of all, we want to tell you today, if you are struggling, if you are thinking, what if I took control of my thoughts? Trust me, we've all been there, right? You are not alone. That's one of the things the devil loves to tell you, is that you are all by yourself, and that is not true. There's a room full of people here today who are currently working through this or who have worked through it before in their lives. So what would that look like? What if I took control of my thoughts? And once again, this is one of the toughest areas of spiritual discipline to master. Amen? Thoughts are a powerful thing, aren't they? I like what Norman Vincent Peale, he told us. He said this. He made this famous, really. He said, change your thoughts and you'll change your world. That's true, isn't it? But I've also heard many critics say, well, it's not that easy. You can't just change your life by changing your thoughts. It can't be done. And here's what I say to those critics. You're right on the first part. It's not easy, is it? It's not easy to do that. But I think you're wrong on the second. Because once again, number one, it's not easy. You have to be ready to do some hard work. Hard work. Are you ready to do some hard work today? Okay, a couple of them. The rest of you, are ready to do some hard work? Amen. Amen. But that is true. It's not easy. It is not easy. Anyone who has tried to change their way of thinking can tell you that. It's not an easy road to hoe, as they would say. And we typically have certain responses kind of built into us. And when we face certain situations, such as stress or fatigue or doubt, or fear, we automatically go to that spot that we are used to going to. And oftentimes in our minds, it's kind of maybe not so good, right? We are programmed to think certain ways about certain things. I want you to write this down, because I want you to write this down to think about it. You have to think on this, and here's why. I want you to write this down. We often think without thinking about what we are thinking about. You have to write that down and think about it. I had to read that a couple, three times before it got in my mind there. But tell me if that's not true. We often think without thinking about what we're thinking about. It's our natural tendency, oftentimes, to think negative. Right? It is. And you do nothing to curb that natural tendency when we don't think about what we're thinking about. We'll get into that here in just a moment. Here's something else that I want you to think about. That the habitual negative thinking, it leads to certain problems that cannot be avoided. If you are a negative thinker, here's the first thing that robs you of. Negative thinking robs you of a life of faith. Do you realize that? It's difficult for us to have an attitude that says, God is bigger than any of my problems. And we would all say that today, wouldn't we? However, sometimes negative thinkers, it's hard to live that way when we approach every problem and we think, well, here we go. Here we go again. This ruins everything. Ever been there? You see, I got my hand up too, so you're not alone. Amen? It's difficult to say, to have the attitude that we like to have in church where we say, I am blessed and I'm highly favored of God. When every little inconvenience comes along, and then we automatically go to that spot and we think, well, isn't this typical? Once again, here we go again, right? If it wasn't for bad luck,
have
no luck at all. We've all said that, haven't we? Usually, hopefully, it's in a time where we can laugh at ourselves sometimes. But when we have those negative thoughts, it robs you of a life of faith. How can I say one thing but think another way? Another problem that negative thinking does is it leads to inactivity. Negative thinking leads to inactivity. Here's what I mean by that. It leads to a what's the use mentality. What's the use mentality? It causes us to think this, why bother trying? I mean, nothing works out anyway. Right? Why go on a diet? I'm just going to starve myself for a few weeks. I'm going to give up. I'm going to give in. I'm going to be right back to where I was to begin with. So all of that pain and agony will be worth nothing. Why even start? That's what negative thinking is all the time. That's what we think all the time. Some people may think, well, why should I try to strengthen my marriage? My spouse doesn't appreciate anything I do anyway. I'll just give and give and give and receive nothing in return. Why even start? You see, when we have that negative thinking, it makes it easier for us to give into the temptation of doing nothing, doesn't it? And because we do nothing, negative thinking often causes isolation in relationships. You realize that, don't you? Negative thinking often causes isolation in relationships. It causes us to focus on what's wrong with the relationship. It tricks us into thinking that nothing can be done about what's wrong. And also, here's what negative thinking does for us. I think it makes us see only the fault in others. And that really prevents us from enjoying the relationship fully and completely the way God wants it to be. However, aren't you glad for to pick me up this morning? However, if, that's a big word, isn't it? Two letters, that's a huge word. However, if, turn to your neighbor and say, if you are willing to do the hard work of taking control of your thought life, it will make a big difference in your life. Amen? Those who have been on both sides of it, they understand that. What kind of difference, you say? Well, positive thinking, it will make you happier. Amen. Doesn't take a brain surgeon to figure that one out, does it? We all know that being happier, positive thinking will lead to happiness more than negative thinking will, right? And let me tell you something from experience, I can tell you. Being happy beats being miserable every single time. Amen?
Amen.
I like being happy, don't you? And another thing that positive thinking will do to us, and we have to understand this, is that positive thinking does not mean that you avoid thinking about negative things. It means you avoid thinking about things negatively. You see how that is? We still understand the situation that we're in. We don't have rose-colored glasses, right? We understand where we are. Negative thinkers, they will tell you this. This is a terrible situation, and there is no solution. Positive thinking will say this. This is a terrible situation. They understand where they're at, right? This is a terrible situation, but they will say, and I'm going to look for ways to make it better. You see the difference there? Our reality is the same. Our outlook. Am I just going to give up and do nothing, or am I going to search for ways to make this better? Positive thinking is action oriented. It's solution minded. It's I'm thinking of what can I do to make this better. And because of this, positive thinking makes you more productive. Did you know that? Positive thinking makes you more productive. Instead of thinking, what's the use? You begin thinking, what do I need to do? You see, when you take control of your thoughts, you spend less time thinking about the things that take you nowhere. We spend too much time thinking about those things, don't we? Where is this going to get me? Nowhere. Let's move that aside. I think when you take control of your thoughts, you will spend less time reliving the past and revisiting regrets. You spend less time thinking about what could have been, and you think about more time thinking about what could be. If, it's a big word again, isn't it? If you will make the effort to control your thought life, it will improve your emotional state. It will improve your spiritual state for sure. It will improve your relationships and even your ability to do your job. Who wants some of that, right? We all do, don't we? So then the question comes down to, how do I do it? That was the longest introduction for a message I think I've ever had. But it's good, and we're already halfway through. Can I get amen on that one? So how do I do this? How can I take control of my thoughts? Pastor Doug, you're telling me I should, and I need to know how. Who wants to know how? Because today I want to give you have your sermon notes there, and your message notes, so continue taking notes and fill in the blanks, and here we go. We're going to look at three ways how you can do these three things, and you can begin to take control of your thought life. Sound good? Here's the three things. Number one, we need to think on purpose. You need to think on purpose. We need to start thinking about what you think about. That's why I had you write down that one earlier in the message there. I like what Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. He says, take captive every thought. Why do we want to take captive of every thought? To make it obedient to Christ. Paul, he's talking about the influence that the world has on our thinking and the belief system that the world tries to push on to us. And we know that the world teaches one philosophy and the Bible teaches another philosophy, right? We know that, don't we? We need to make sure that our thoughts, our thinking, aligns with the biblical philosophy, the biblical model. I'm by myself quite a bit. Is anybody else here by themselves quite a bit? And so you know, we are alone with your thoughts, and sometimes that can not be so good, because I've learned this. If I'm by myself and my thoughts go unchecked, your thoughts, they can kind of carry you to some crazy places. Have you ever been there? See, I'm the only one holding my hand up today, but that's okay. We've all been there, haven't we? Sometimes our thoughts can do that, can't they? Let me just give you a quick, easy example. Let's say that you, maybe you're watching TV, or you're reading a book, or even you're flipping through social media, whatever, and you see an ad for a brand new car, or in my case, a brand new truck. Arr, yeah. And you think to yourself, oh man, isn't that awesome? Isn't that beautiful, that brand new vehicle? Man, wouldn't that be great to be able to get that? And then you start to think to yourself, I can't afford that on what I make and with the demands on my life and not with this economy. You know, I don't see how it's ever going to get better. I guess the days of prosperity are all pretty much over. I will never be able to get that. Whoa, whoa, poor pitiful me. Ever been there? See how easy your thoughts can take you down a rabbit hole, how your thoughts can take you and literally drag you down, and you can lose an entire afternoon feeling sorry for yourself. And if you're not careful, that'll run into the next day, won't it? And maybe the next day, and before long, you're like, this has been a bad week. How did I get here? But it was that one thing you saw a week ago that just made you start going down. Why? Because your thought process, a lot of times we automatically go to the negative. I could never get that. Man, that's why we need to take captive every thought. Every thought. When a thought enters your mind, here's what we need to do. We need to grab hold of it before it has a chance to wander. Before it has a chance to take you down rabbit holes. And you need to look at it. You need to pull that thought apart. You need to evaluate it. You need to weigh it against Scripture. And you need to see if it measures up. And if it does, allow that thought through. If it doesn't, you need to get rid of it. So first thing we need to do to help us get victory in our thought life is this. We need to learn to think on purpose. We have to be intentional about things. Amen? So number one, we've got to think on purpose. Think on purpose for a purpose. That's to have good thoughts. You ready for number two?
Yes.
Number two, we need to think with a filter. Think with a filter. I used to have a fish tank. I enjoyed having a fish tank. It was fun. It's something I enjoyed. Maybe one day I'll have another fish tank. But then you see the fish floating around in that water. And boy, the stress, you just, just kind of floats away, don't it? And it's fun to watch all the fish come around. But you see what's on the back of a tank, right? You can see it there in that picture. That's the water filter, isn't it? You see, what happens is that water in the fish tank, it if you didn't have that filter, that environment would become stagnant and dirty, and the fish would not be able to survive, right? So what the water filter does is it pulls water up from the fish tank. It goes through the filter. The filter traps all the dirt and holds it back, and it allows the clean water to go through back into the tank. That's kind of what Paul, he's suggesting that we use the filter for our thoughts, and he gives us that filter. He gives it to us in Philippians 4. Verse 8, and Paul, he says, finally, brothers and sisters, remember, brothers and sisters, he's talking to Jesus' followers, he's talking to us today. He says, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. That is your filter. Amen, church? It's good to memorize this list. It's actually a list that's not that hard to memorize. There's 8 things on this list. And as you think about the thoughts, because remember, we're thinking on purpose. So as the thoughts come into my mind, I can flow them, if you will, through this filter. And as the thoughts are running through your mind, you run the thoughts through this and you ask yourself, is it true? Is my thought noble? Is it right? Is it pure? Is it lovely? Is my thought, is it admirable? Is it excellent? Is it praiseworthy? And if it is, allow that thought to go through that filter and pour into your life. If that thought is not any of those, let that filter stop it. Don't spend all your day on that thought. Get it out of your mind. Sometimes we need a redirect, don't we? I think a filter can help us be a redirect too. Web designers, they use this little trick, and I think it's a pretty cool little trick. If you go to a website or a web page, and let's say that web page has went to a new location. Sometimes you go to that old one, and it automatically redirects you to the new one, the correct one. That's a pretty cool tool that they use, that they're able to put in there. Maybe something like that, we can do that with our thought process too. Maybe that's a trick that we can use. It's a good tool for our thought habit. Here's what I like to tell people. When you find yourself thinking something that you should not, you should practice a redirect. And I tell people this, and I've probably told you, I'm sure you've heard me say this before. You know what a great redirect is? When you're thinking thoughts that shouldn't be in here, how can I get this thought? I need to redirect my mind. I tell people, listen to Christian music. That's the easiest thing to do. It may be Kayla for you. It may be putting in a Gaither CD, amen. It may be telling Alexa to put on Elevation Worship. Whatever that looks like for you, put on that Christian music, that gospel music. Because here's what happens. At least it works for me. Anyway. My thoughts go from, oh, poor pitiful me. And as that music starts coming into my mind, my thoughts begin to change. They begin to think, God, aren't you good? Aren't you amazing? Aren't you worthy of my praise? Aren't you much better than I thought I was thinking a minute ago? Amen? That's a redirect. So we want to think with a filter and put that redirect in there. So number one, we want to think on purpose. Think about what you're thinking about. And then number two, we want to run our thoughts through a filter and throw in a redirect right there if we need to. And that runs right into number three. Number three thing is think in a direction of change. Think in the direction of change. Think in a direction of change. George Bernard Shaw, he said this, Those who cannot change their minds cannot change anything. You must be determined to change. Amen? We can't just sit here on a Sunday morning and say, amen, Pastor Doug, that sounds great. I'm going to change my thoughts, and I'm going to use these three keys that you have given me, and I'm going to put them to use, and then go out tomorrow, and that first thought that comes in, just give up. You must be determined to change. You've got to get in there. You've got to be ready to do the hard work. Amen? Paul, he tells us once again in Romans, he says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Change your mind. Put in the good thoughts. He tells us in Ephesians, he says, be made new in the attitude of your minds. Think good things. Check against that list of eight that we talked about just a moment ago. Horton and Vincent Peale, I told you at the beginning he said, change your thoughts and you'll change your world. I think we can make that even more personal by saying, change your thoughts and you'll change yourself. Amen? Who wants a better version of you? We all want that better version, don't we? This is a big part of that, I think. Taking control of your thought life doesn't mean that you think only good things. Remember that. You still realize and understand the reality that you are in. But taking control of your thought life, it means that you become a new person. You make a difference in the world around you. Here's what the right attitude says. If you can come to this and you can say, God, I want to learn differently. I want to learn to think differently. Because I want to learn to act differently. Because I want to be a different person. That's what it all boils down to, isn't it? Henry David Thoreau, he said this. He said, as a single footstep will not make a path on the earth, so a single thought will not make a pathway in the mind. To make a path on the earth, on the ground, you have to go over that piece of ground again and again and again and again, and the path begins to wear, doesn't it? Same thing with our thought process. We have to, in order to get that deep mental path that we want, the good thought process, we must think over and over and over the kinds of thoughts that we want to think, the kinds of thoughts that we want to dominate our lives. So what if I took control of my thought life? It's hard work. It's not a one-time event. Often it's a daily process. You have to get up every morning. You have to decide, what am I going to do today? I think that if you will learn to think the way that like God has told us to think, that you will experience transformation, I believe, in all your areas of life, because right thinking always leads you in the direction of action. And when we are action, when we are active in our faith, good things happen. Change your thoughts, and you will change your life. You will change yourself, and you will change your world. Amen, church? So let me ask you, where are you today? Where are you at right now? Are you ready to take that first step in changing your thoughts today? Maybe you're here and you're like, you know, this is good. And then you see these three things and you're like, yeah, I can do that. And are you ready to make a change today? Are you ready to put in the hard work? It may start today, but it continues tomorrow and the next day and the next day and the next day. That even the day after that doesn't. Because we want to get that thought path. We have to think those thoughts over and over and over again. So let's think on purpose. Think with the filter and think in the direction of change. Are you ready to do that today? If you are, and we'll just wait for a few moments, and maybe you want to come down to the altar today, and maybe you just want to talk with Jesus and say, okay, Jesus, I'm ready to take control of my thought life. I'm ready for you to lead me through this. I'm ready for you to help me with this, because we want to help you. That's what we're here for. We're here to do life together. So we're just going to wait for just a few moments, and if anyone would want to come and anyone else want to come and just say, you know what, I'm going to take control of my thought life, and today I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to do it, because I'm tired of those negative thoughts. I want to have positive thoughts in my life. I want to think the way the Bible tells me to think. I don't want to allow the devil to rob me of a life of faith. Anybody else want to come forward today and just pray? Because God will help you. We are here to help you as well. Anyone else? You know, there's always room for more. Amen? Because remember, Jesus came that we may have life and have it to the full. We may have life abundantly. And a big part of that is your thought life. Anyone else want to come down and pray today? Join these people and support them in their prayers. You can come down and pray with them as well. That's always good to let them know that they're not alone. It's one thing for us to say that. It's another thing for us to do that. Amen. People definitely appreciate the encouragement. Father God, we come to you today, Lord, and we say thank you. We say thank you, God, because we know you're the God of the mountaintops, and that's an easy time to see you and to feel you, God. But we also know that when we're down in the valley and that negative thinking comes upon us, God, and we have those negative thoughts, we know you are the God of the valley as well. We thank you, Jesus, that you are with us in the good times and the not so good times. We thank you, God, that we can lean on you. We thank you, God, that we can take our thoughts and we can compare them to Scripture and we can see, is this something that I should be thinking, God? And you show us a way that we can get rid of those and we can redirect our minds, God. And Father, we thank you for all that you give to us. Father, we want to lift these up today that have come forward, and God, we believe that there's more who are in their seats or maybe be watching online at some point, Father, we want to pray for them as well. God, we pray that these that are here, Father God, that they would see, they would feel your presence in a brand new way, Lord. God, that no matter what their thought process may be, Father, we know, God, that they can have a brand new thought life today, Lord. God, and when we renew our mind, Lord, when we do the things that you want us to do, Father, when we think the way you want us to think, God, we know that is how that you can bless us, you can give us good life. We thank you, Father, that you are here to give us that life abundantly, Lord. Because this world is a crazy place. We've all lived in it long enough to understand that, Father. We've all lived in it long enough to understand and see that the devil wants nothing more than to take our life away from us, God, and that often happens in our thoughts. And he drags us down. But Father, you are greater than anything in this world. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And Father, we want to pray your name over these people today, God. We pray that the devil would be bound in the name of Jesus. We pray that negative thoughts would start to go away. We pray, God, that we would take these things that we've learned from your word today, Lord, and we would put them into practice. And God, that you would become bigger and bigger every moment of our life. We know you can do that, God. You are the only way that we can survive this life. We thank you, Father, for all that you have done. We thank you for what you are doing, not only in the lives of people here, God, but in the lives of people that we may never see, who may watch this online, God, in the lives of those who are across this world worshiping you today. We thank you for that. God, we thank you that somehow you are a global God. You know exactly what everybody's going through. And at the same time, God, you love us so much, you know exactly what's going on in my life. Thank you that you love us. Thank you, God, that we can run to you, that you can protect us, you can hold us. You can mold us into more and more being like Jesus. And Father, may we share your story with others even this week. Thank you, God. And we do worship you and we honor you, Father. We lift you high in this place. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. God bless you, church. We love you. Most importantly, God loves you, right? Go and share some of that positive thinking with this world because the world needs it. Amen. Go be Jesus with someone this week. God bless you. God is with you.